listeners, welcome to another episode of The Book Table from Backroom Whispering. Today we're going to be discussing Shadowshaper by Danielle Jose Older. I'm Dorothy. I am going to be your moderator today, although I did read the book, so I may be interjecting my opinions at some points. And who else do I have today?
I'm Louisa. I've been on one other Book Table episode. If you remember me, it would be from the Religion and YA Fantasy episode. And I'm pretty excited to talk about this book today.
Hi, I'm Sara. I've been on like 1.5 episodes. There was one episode where Dorothy just read my comments, but I'm really excited about talking about this book. I really enjoyed it, and I think that there's a lot to say.
Hey everyone, I'm Shelly. I haven't been on Book Table for a while, but I'm back, so I'm excited to talk about this book because it's pretty different from what we've been reading recently. So, yeah. Exciting.
So that's actually a good first point to start with. What makes this book so unique? Like, what would make someone pull this off the shelf instead of a random other fantasy or even urban fantasy book?
Well, the cover, for starters, absolutely gorgeous. I actually kind of like regret having read it on my Kindle. But the thing that struck me first about reading this book was definitely that the main character is Afro-Latina, and like, in YA fantasy, you really don't run into that all that often. So that was, like, super exciting.
Yeah, I think I definitely agree with that. Something that I always do, which is, like, maybe not a good thing to do, but for the book club that we run that usually we're reading these books in, I tend to vote for the books based on the cover. I literally judge the book based on the cover. And I was really excited about this book for exactly that reason. And I liked that it had a real-world setting a lot, because I think a lot of the books that I've been reading recently that fall into the fantasy genre have been completely made-up settings. So it was really nice to kind of have a grounding in the real world, I think. It was really interesting.
Yeah, so I definitely agree with all of that. I also haven't read sort of an urban fantasy for a while, so that was definitely exciting. And it's sort of a setting that I've never really read before. Like, I've read plenty of books set in New York City, but, you know, the specific neighborhood, these kinds of people, I really didn't know what to expect, and so that's kind of what I wanted to, you know, I wanted to read it to find out what this kind of world was like, as well as, you know, the cool, you know, magic that was going on. But really, that was kind of a background to the actual, like, culture and setting of the book, which I thought was really cool.
Okay, I guess I forgot to mention in the intro, so first, we're going to do a spoiler-free discussion, and we're just going to talk about our general opinions on the book and what we liked, what we didn't like, without spoiling it. So if you haven't read this book, it's safe to listen to the first segment of this podcast. We will discuss the world, the settings, the writing style, but not, like, who the bad guy is or anything that will ruin the story for you. And then we'll do a little break, we'll play our lovely theme music, and we'll go on to a spoiler section. So bearing in mind that we're still in the spoiler-free section, do you guys have any thoughts about the writing style? We had a note in our discussion document that the narrator sometimes switches registers. Did you guys find that natural or distracting?
I guess I wasn't really sure what this meant. I don't remember whose comment it was, but what do we mean by registers here? Because that, I don't know, maybe I don't really understand the meaning.
I just mean, like, formal versus informal versus, like, sometimes there's slang in the narration and sometimes there isn't.
Well, I think the use of slang is definitely a writing style point. You don't read that many books, or at least I haven't read that many books that use a lot of...
Yeah, I feel like the slang I read is always, like, some kind of British, like, Cockney or something.
Oh, yeah, especially in
And that's,
fantasy.
Like, it.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. I thought it was well done in that it didn't really feel forced. I feel a lot of times when YA books include slang, it feels like I'm like just trying to be hip with the kids.
Oh my gosh,
but
yeah.
This felt really real, and I think it was because not only like it wasn't like only young people's slang. Do you know what I mean? Like, it was the whole neighborhood, and it was very natural and things people actually say in real life and not just like too cool for school or whatever. So
yeah. I actually, I pulled a quote from one of the older characters in the book. I believe it's our main character's godfather. And he said, "I seen enough to know what's what when there's some woo-woo mess going down. I'll stick to the human side being a badass. Thank you very much." And that's very natural. That reads...
Yeah, it's perfect.
This is just how this person talked. So it sounds very natural. It sounds like this is the vocabulary that he uses. This is the syntax that he uses. This is how he speaks in his everyday life. It's not, like you said, trying to keep up with the kids.
And I think that really gets into another thing that's kind of unique about this book, actually, at least in my experience, in that the characters range hugely in age. And like even the characters actually involved in the supernatural goings on range hugely in age. I feel like with a lot of YA fantasy, at least in my experience, you mostly have like a few kids who are in on it and maybe like one adult. And it's like this big secret. Whereas here you really get like the full gamut of people involved.
I think that's kind of one of the themes of this book, was that it's about community. And so it wouldn't really make sense for it to be like, for her to be an isolated kind of protagonist. I feel like it's because the theme of the novel is like this neighborhood community and how people interact. So it wouldn't be the same. It would be impossible.
Yeah. So Louisa released a blog post about the importance of Bennie as a supportive best friend, but really, we don't just have a supportive best friend. We've got a supportive godfather. We've got a supportive community librarian. I mean, it really is a very important aspect of this book. It's not just some girl with superpowers and a sword. It's her and her friend's family banding together.
And I think the presence of that network contributes to the overall feeling of it being like a more real setting. Like, in real life, teenagers interact with people of all ages all the time. And so, like, books that are just, like, for teenagers against the world or whatever, like, don't... Like, they feel unreal in a way beyond just because they're fantasy. Because, like, you have parents that just, like, fade into background characters and, like, teachers that fade into background characters and maybe a nuisance every once in a while, but, like, they're not, like, constantly interacting with people of other generations, and they don't like have that sort of support network. Sierra has a remarkable support network.
Yeah, I really appreciated that about this book, that you know, a lot of times in YA novels or other fantasy novels, you just see you know, maybe the teenagers try to do everything on their own and, you know, have all these issues doing it, but she wasn't really afraid to, you know, ask for help from, you know, the adult figures in her life, which I thought was pretty awesome of her. She wasn't, like, convinced that she could just do everything, you know, without asking anyone for their help.
I'd actually like to touch back on that when we get to the spoiler section, because there was an instance of asking for help that I felt seemed kind of unnatural, but it's pretty spoilery, so we'll go there later.
Well, get okay.
There. So, the realism of the neighborhood and the community, what did you guys think about the use of bilingual characters in this book? We had people who would go back and forth between English and Spanish in the same sentence. Did you think that was done well? Did you think you needed more translation or less translation? Do you guys speak Spanish?
I don't speak Spanish. I am bilingual, but I speak French. And so I actually really appreciated the way that Older did this. Because one thing about the Spanish words is none of the Spanish words are italicized. They're all just, like Dorothy said, they're, like, switching in the middle of sentences and, like, incorporating words that, like, whichever words make sense to use regardless of language, sort of. And that's something that definitely happens in a bilingual household, in my experience. I lived in France in an English-French bilingual household, and it's really, like... I feel like books that italicize the other language or, like set it apart somehow make it seem like that's how your brain works when you're speaking two languages, and it's really not. Like, your brain doesn't make, like, separate schema, doesn't make, like, separate areas for the separate languages. And so, I don't know, I thought it was a lot more realistic that they kind of wove it into, like, how they would when they were talking naturally.
I agree with that 100%. I would say I live in a bilingual household right now.
Mm-hmm.
I live with my boyfriend, and our first languages are different. So we're always switching back and forth between the two. And it's like, yeah, it's in the middle of sentences. We use certain words in one language, but not the other. I don't speak Spanish. So I think that the translations were necessary in that he's marketing the book to English speakers. But I thought it was a little bit strange that sometimes the characters would like translate themselves. Like, I can't think of a good example, but they would say one thing and then the next sentence, like, say the exact same thing again.
Yeah, I have a quote for that. Her mother is explaining some weird stuff that's going on in the family, and she says, "Es una locura." I don't speak Spanish. I'm sorry. She says, "Es una locura, Sierra. Family eccentricities." And okay, I get it. Like, I don't know what locura means when I'm reading it, but to say "es una locura, Sierra, family eccentricities," that doesn't seem terribly natural to me. And then the direct translation for "una locura" is "crazy." So she basically said, "It's crazy, Sierra, family craziness." And that's not doesn't sound to me like the most natural sentence.
So on the other hand, I don't know how you would get around that, because I'm complaining about it, but I don't know how he would have fixed it either, so.
Well, instead of directly translating it in the next sentence, it could be like, "Es una locura, Sierra, people have always said that this family is crazy," or something like rather than a direct translation in the next line.
Well, I mean, it's already kind of not a direct translation.
Because it's eccentricities. Right,
it's family eccentricities. I don't know, I feel like that does happen a little bit, and maybe it's just, I mean, when I lived in France, I lived with kids, I was an au pair, and one of them was definitely still, like, learning languages, so maybe we, like, said things in both a little more often with him, but I feel like that does happen sometimes, like, especially for emphasis. I don't know, though.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that, like, overall, on the whole, I appreciated that he didn't do that a lot, because I think I've seen it in other books that, you know, that's done way more often, that you have something and then it's translated right away. And I always feel like that's kind of condescending. Like, you know, you could look it up if you wanted to know. But also, like, his word choice in this book was really good. Like, it was things that you mostly didn't really need to know Spanish for. I think that, like, you know, there were words that maybe weren't completely essential. They were just kind of, like, flavor, maybe. Or sort of, not quite accents, but, like, putting a sort of Spanish spin on English words. I thought that was really interesting. And it's super accurate. Like, definitely people do that in real life, not only with Spanish, but with other languages. I did take 3 years of Spanish, so maybe I did have more of a background, so I didn't, and you know, I didn't need to look up most of it, so maybe it was less inconvenient for someone like that.
I mean, I've taken no Spanish at all, and I think, like, most of the things that he used, like you said, that he had, like, sort of, like, alongside English things, were phrases that were, like, common enough that, like, even if you don't speak Spanish, if you live in this country where some people speak Spanish, like, you will know what they mean. And I also, like, I think the only thing that I really would have needed translated is the poem and the way that he works in how she does a translation of that and, like, uses her friends, some of whom don't speak Spanish, makes it work pretty well, and, like, it doesn't feel like it's super contrived that she would be translating it.
Yeah, and I just wanted to note that I read this book on Google Play Books, and it was really awesome that they have a built-in, like, translator. Like, most ebook readers just have the dictionary, but you could just, you know, tap something and instantly translate it, which is super useful, especially if you're reading, you know, a book in a foreign language or something. So, pro tip, if you're doing that, Google Play.
Okay. So another discussion topic that we had was body positivity and race positivity. As we mentioned before, our main character, Sierra, is Afro-Latina, and she loves it. She owns it. She rocks it. She's got a fro that she talks about loving. She loves her skin tone, and she also loves her body shape. She talks about having a little bit of extra belly fat, and she has no problem with it, and her romantic interests have no problem with it. What did you guys think about this aspect of the book?
I about died. At, like, all of this.
In,
like,
a good way?
In a very good way. Like, I could hardly believe it. I actually, like, when I got to a scene that was, like, positive like that, I, like, actually went back and, like, checked the author's name and, like, looked him up because I, like, couldn't, I could hardly believe that this was, like, coming from a man, frankly. Like, to have this girl talking about, like, her body and how she, like, and how she felt about it and how she built her self-esteem about it and everything. And I have nothing else to say about that.
I thought that it was great that this is a YA novel. I thought that young adult novels with main characters that have the potential to be this kind of role model for growing young girls was, it's kind of rare. And I think that it was, well, not rare necessarily, but rare in this way. And I thought it was really refreshing and really nice. And I, especially because there's literally a scene where she stands in front of the mirror and looks at herself and decides that she loves her the way she looks. And I thought that was, like, she acknowledges that she has faults and things that she doesn't like about herself or she didn't like about herself in the past necessarily. Like, maybe she has acne or I can't remember what she says exactly. But in the end, like, I don't know. I just thought that was a really powerful scene.
Yeah, I thought, I loved it. And I thought it was really interesting that she did, that it was really realistic, I guess, that she in the past had sort of doubted herself. She did have some, like, insecurities. She, you know, the people around her, you know, characters that we'll mention in the spoiler section, you know, some of them aren't as positive as she ended up being, but, you know, over time she kind of grew to love the way she was. And I thought that was really great and, yeah, more realistic because she wasn't always, like, super happy with the way she was. And I think that's pretty true to, you know, being a teenager, really.
Exactly. If your world is going to be realistic, you can't have, and everyone loves themselves and there's no bullies and no racists ever. Because that's just not the reality that we live in. And so it really brought it home and made her look stronger in comparison and made her stronger because she has faced people who don't feel the same. So I loved it as well. I thought that was great. It did not feel forced in any way. It didn't feel like, oh, also we're going to be body positive now. It was just, she's getting dressed and she looks in the mirror and she's like, dang.
I think it was like, it was clearly, the thing is that it did feel natural, but it was like clearly a conscious choice, like on his part to make sure to include this and to include it as a thread that goes like all the way through the novel. Pretty much. Like, it's not just, like, we keep talking about that one scene, but it's not just, like, the one moment where she talks about her body. She kind of talks about it, like, throughout throughout the book, and it's clearly deliberate, but it fits really well into the narrative without feeling like it's contrived.
Yeah, I think it fits in with a lot of the themes of this book, which we'll talk about more later, I think, but a lot of the themes are, like, family and where you come from and the power of that. And so I think to have her, to have this Puerto Rican character and have her not think about these things, especially when it comes to like racism and even colorism, which I thought was really interesting. That's usually overlooked in YA novels or in novels in general, actually. So I think that to have her not think about these things and have it, to have it overlooked would have been, that would have been strange. So I thought it was really well done.
Okay, so Louisa had mentioned that she had to double check and see that the author was a man. And I also had that moment. But for me, that moment came when she was catcalled.
Yeah.
Our main character is somebody random in the streets decides that it's cool to talk about her body. And she has this very realistic response to it. And I was like, oh yeah, the author, she did that really well. And then I was like, wait. The author's not a she. Because a lot of times, even though, not to get too personal, but like men in our lives will be supportive and, oh, I'm sorry they did that to you, that was mean. It's not necessarily what I consider the same level of understanding or ability to write a character like that. So did you guys have any thoughts about the catcalling and just in general a male author writing such a badass, kick-ass female character?
Oh, I really appreciated that. So she gets catcalled more than once. And I, one thing I really appreciated is that her response was like dependent partly on like her mood at the time. Like sometimes it was just like, don't engage. Like, I'm just going to leave. And like one time I think she flips a guy off.
Yeah. I thought it was really realistic and I don't know. I props to him.
Yeah. I mean, I guess I think it's pretty great that he wrote this awesome, like, super brave young female character who's, you know, the main character of his books. I didn't really think about it while I was reading, but it definitely is unique, you know, the catcalling and just the, you know, even the body image stuff, like something I wouldn't expect to come from a male author, of course. And yeah, I mean, I thought it was definitely great of him to tackle those topics. He's being a great role model for, you know, young guys to think about, like, what they're doing, you know, in their daily lives.
And to maybe actually listen to women.
Well, Louisa just kind of muttered, but she said to actually listen to the women in their lives. My conclusion when I read the catcalling scene, I posted in the book club group, I said, so either there's actual witchcraft involved here, or he really does listen to the women about the women in his life about their experience. And I think that that's a really, really important lesson that a lot of people can take and run with.
Yep.
So before we go into our spoiler section, just one more time, general overview. We all said in the intro that we were excited to talk about, but how would you rate or recommend this book? How many stars would you give it? Who would you recommend it to? And I'll actually go first because I'm an attention hog like that. I gave it 4 stars. I thought it was an incredibly well done book. I'm very stingy with my 5-star ratings. I would probably do 4.5 if I could, but Goodreads is limited that way. I would recommend this to pretty much anyone who likes books that feature the supernatural. I know that they're not everyone's cup of tea, but if you've liked other books that have spirits and magic and plots, then I would definitely recommend it.
So as you might have just heard, we had a little bit of technical difficulty during this next bit, so I'm just going to summarize. Louisa gave it 5 stars. She thinks that it's very important, and she'd recommend it to anyone who likes the supernatural, but also every young girl for the representation, body positivity, race positivity. She thinks everyone should read it.
I would probably give it 4 stars. I agree with everything that you've said until now, but we'll talk about this more in the spoiler section. I think that there were some parts of the plot that I felt were kind of left unfinished. Not necessarily unfinished, but like I had a lot of questions at the end. And I'm the kind of person that likes my books to be like wrapped up as much as possible.
Yeah, so I think I'd give it probably something like 4.5 stars. I do agree that the plot sometimes had little issues. For me, that wasn't like a main focus. Like, I was really just interested to get into the world and experience it. So I didn't mind that too much. I kind of like once in a while when things are left vague and you can kind of, you know, use your imagination as to what's going on. There were a little bit, like, there were parts that felt a little rushed to me, which I guess, I mean, it helped me finish the book in time for this recording, so there's that. But yeah, overall, I think just for the, you know, the culture that it kind of captured, I really liked it. So I definitely recommend it to anyone who's looking for something more unusual, but not just focused, you know, in the real world. So I think it does a good job of sort of capturing the real world, but, you know, adding that twist that makes it maybe more exciting for people to get into. So yeah, I think it's not limited to people who like supernatural books or fantasy. I think anyone could really enjoy it. And so something not related to this that I wanted to mention. Earlier we talked about italicizing Spanish, and so I found that the author has a YouTube video about this topic, which is really funny, and you guys should check it out. So,
oh, yeah.
That's
I read
all.
An interview where he talked about it, but I haven't seen a video, so that could be fun.
It has a costume change.
Oh my gosh, are you serious,
several.
Daniel?
Perfect. All right, so we'll link that in the episode description. Is there anything else that we wanted to cover before we move on to our spoiler section? All right, so welcome back. We are now in the spoiler section. That means if you continue to listen, you can't blame us if you got spoiled because we warned you. We touched a little bit earlier about the importance of community, but what about the importance of culture, ancestors, and family? I felt that it would be wise to keep this to the spoiler section because some of the stuff that's been passed down in her family is magical and therefore a spoiler. But what did you guys think about the whole use of family and ancestry in this book?
So I think of two main things. When I think of the use of family and ancestry in this book, One is Sierra's family and their history with shadow shaping. And the other thing is Robbie and Robbie's tattoos, especially, which are another way of like sort of manifesting that idea that you know, can and should be proud of your culture and you can be proud of your heritage.
I thought it was really interesting, but at the end of the spoiler-free part, I said there were some things about the plot that I found confusing. And one of those things was that this magic was set up to be like the power of your ancestors, and it's like a family thing. Mm-hmm. But then there's also all these like random people who can do it, like all of her grandfather's friends and the villain. And I thought it was kind of weird. It was like, is this a thing only from their family? Or is this a thing like from their home countries that then became a neighborhood thing when they moved to New York? Or I don't know. I thought the power comes from their ancestors, but then I thought that it was confusing as far as like creating rules for magic was concerned. And I guess that's because recently I've been reading a lot of fantasy books with very clearly outlined rules for their magic systems. And this was less magic and more supernatural. So there aren't really clear rules. And I found that to be a little bit confusing, but also interesting. So I'd like to hear everybody else's thoughts on that.
So I thought it was clear that the magic was tied into like ancestral spiritualism, but I don't think that it's like just supposed to be Sierra's family. Like, I don't think that they're the only origin of it. Like, obviously her grandmother is Lucera, so like that at least shows that like her family is certainly probably the most important shadow shaping family. But I think it came out of like the background culture that a bunch of the characters share. And then obviously like when people move into neighborhoods, they tend to move into areas where there are other people like them. So I think I think it was something that like came from older generations to newer generations. And I do think it was really unclear at the end what was going on, because it seemed like the rest of Sierra's friends were like getting initiated into it almost. But like, as far as I knew, they didn't share Puerto Rican heritage. So I'm not totally sure what.
But the bad guy doesn't.
What's going on there? Well, he doesn't, but he was also, like, I feel like that was really, like, that was clear appropriation, and that was, like, him being sort of a really predatory dude, and, like, first taking the powers from the Sorrows, which weren't of his culture, and then, like, sort of infiltrating the Shadow Shapers and, like, trying to steal that power, too.
Well, wait, wasn't it the other way around that he became a Shadow Shaper because of his you know, friendship with Sierra's grandfather? And, he gave Wick his Shadow Shaper powers, and then, you know, the Sorrow stuff happened after
that?
No,
he got the power from the Sorrows before, because they were reading, when they were reading his diary, it was like, I have these powers from the Sorrows, and now I just have to convince Lazaro that I should have Shadow Shaper powers too, and then, like, and then I should convince Lucera that I should have her powers too, obviously, because I'm clearly the best. That's my
The shadows list. Thing, the Sorrows thing was like, I think it was connected to, he had been studying some other culture that had like binding powers.
Yeah.
So it was, he was like an anthropologist, right? So he studied this other group and took their powers and then, or like learned how to do their powers. And then now he's studying the Shadow Saber group and learned how to do their powers. But it was definitely that the grandfather gave the powers to him, because that's how Sierra got hers, like from the grandmother, and her brothers got it from the grandfather. Mm-hmm. And then like her, that's why her mom can't do it, because she never got the powers. She never wanted it. But yeah. I think that it was clearly stated that Wick was less powerful than he had hoped. And I think that might be because he didn't have any blood connection to it. That it was just, here, you can have the ability to be a Shadow Shaper, but your power is not necessarily as strong because you don't have this connection to it that we have.
Oh, but at the same time, like, sense.
Maybe...
Yeah, that's really interesting.
Maybe, I think it's not necessarily a Puerto Rican thing, but like a Puerto Rican Caribbean island thing, because I think Robbie was from Haiti, right? So
yeah, Robbie's Haitian.
Mm-hmm.
So that, but he
they
was.
They mentioned. Sorry, they actually mention like the name of the native Haitian people that he's descended from, and I can't find it to save my life.
I think it's Taino.
Yes. Good on Shelly for having just read the book today.
Yeah, well, I'm actually, like, searching through the book right now for, like, these little things that I've noted, so, yeah.
So, yeah, I think the power comes from the Tainos, because, so there's a scene where Robbie says, that's a Taino, Sierra, and she says, what? But you're Haitian. I thought Tainos were my peeps. Nah, Haiti had them, too. Has them, you know. So, I think, yeah, the Shadowshaper power at least derives from the Tainos, older Native Caribbean folks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that does make sense.
I'm satisfied with this answer. Okay. I feel happy now. I'll increase my rating to 5 stars now. I feel satisfied.
Wow.
I mean,
we've solved the problem.
A full 5, but yeah.
Ooh, should we go into why I don't want to give it a full 5?
Sure.
So we didn't actually discuss the romantic aspects at all in our
spoiler-free
section. That is one of the reasons why I didn't give it a full 5 stars. I felt that at times the romantic aspect seemed forced. And it could be that other people have a different reading of it than me. And, like, yes, I understand they're in stressful situations together. I get it. But sometimes, I mean, she has her very, I'm not interested in boys, boys are annoying thing. And I would have been totally fine if she had just kept that the whole time.
Well, okay, what she actually has is not like, I'm not interested in boys, boys are annoying. It's like, I don't
have time.
Sorry, it's more like, I don't really want to talk to cute boys because as soon as they open their mouths, they show that they're idiots and I don't like them. But Robbie opens his mouth and isn't an idiot. And she's like, oh, never mind. But, like, to me, what felt weird about that subplot was more, like, the wording sometimes. Like, there are parts where, like, I don't know, it's, like, the narrator gets, like, less poetic than the narrator usually is in this book, and is just, like, she thought about grabbing him and making out, blah, 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 and you were, like, okay, like, that happened in that sentence, I guess, but, like, there's no, like, I think there are moments where it is more like, where it is a little subtler and a little less like, okay, that happened. But yeah, no, I do agree that there's definitely some parts of that were like, why is this happening right now?
I definitely see what you mean. I think that it didn't feel like force or rush to me, at least in the beginning of it starting. Because, like, they're both artists. She doesn't know a lot of other artists. She thinks she's impressed by him and his mural painting. And I think there's a lot of time that they spend together that's not necessarily set, like, deliberately, not deliberately, but, like, clearly stated in the books. Because they finish this huge mural together over the course of this novel. And I think that the pages, like, they sat and painted together are just maybe not there.
Yeah, but
it's heavily implied that they spent a lot of time together, and that so I think that the forming of this relationship was very natural for me. But you could kind of see it coming; that was fine. And then I think the scene maybe that you were referencing was when it's towards the end, right? That she's thinking about like, oh, like I'm really in love with him, but I just want to make out with him. Blah blah blah. That was like a huge red flag for me because like then what? Like the next scene, like he's been taken away or something.
Oh yeah, and no, so, that was clearly like that's not going to happen now. Like okay,
yeah. So I think
like, something's going to happen.
Yeah, I think the tone change was like abrupt, but it was like supposed to be like a red flag kind of thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I don't think it was necessarily like she's suddenly crazy about him. I think it was just like a narration technique.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, I was mostly fine with the romantic stuff. You know, I usually enjoy romance plots, so you know, maybe that's just me. But yeah, I thought it went pretty naturally. Like Sara said, they were kind of like mostly friends for the first, I guess, I don't know, first 3/4 of the book. Yeah, and I kind of liked how they were both, you know, artists. They kind of admired each other for their skills, mm-hmm. rather than, you know, like, oh, you know, he's so cute. I mean, he was cute, but it didn't really come up as much, I think, after, you know, just the beginning introduction. It was more like, oh, you know, he's so talented at, you know, the art, and he, you know, has these skills that, you know, he's explaining to her and that sort of thing.
It's interesting that you say that in that version, because there's definitely one part, which I can't... Yeah. Where, like, she points out explicitly that part of what she likes about him is that he likes her for more than, like, what she's used to. She says, he admired her. She could see it all over him. It was the strength of her shadow shaping, yes, but it was something else, too. He respected her strength, her mind, her power. She never felt that from a boy before. So she's, like, pointed out explicitly that, like, hey, like, this is more than just, like, I like you, you're cute. Which is nice.
Yeah, exactly. And there was, like, another moment, I think, when, you know, after she sort of reveals to him that she's Lucera, he's, like, you know, the look on his face changes a little bit, that he's, like, suddenly a little bit, like, more smitten with her, I think was the word. And, you know, I thought that was kind of awesome. Like, he wasn't scared of her new power or anything like that. He wasn't jealous. He was just sort of more into her than before, which, you know, maybe it's unusual.
Yeah, because this is clearly a situation where, like, she's better at it than he is. And, like, really early on, too. Like, when she first starts learning, even, like, she beats him in their first little scuffle. And the fact that he's not turned off, like, by that. He doesn't, like, act like it's going to be a competition or anything. Like, that, yeah, that doesn't happen all that often, things like this. So that was nice.
Speaking of Robbie, maybe this segue is too soon, but speaking of Robbie, can we talk about her friends and her family's reaction to their relationship? Because especially her family, like her aunt, we couldn't talk about this earlier because it's a spoiler, but I thought this was a really big deal in this book. So could we talk about that a little bit? Not necessarily Tia Rosa in general, but specifically her relationship with Robbie and how everyone reacts to that.
Absolutely. I think that's a great topic to talk about. So Tia Rosa is the one we were hinting at earlier, who was kind of racist, skin tonist, don't ever date a guy who's darker than you, like, blah, blah, blah. Just really...
She's basically, like, the personification of, like, internalized racism.
Mm-hmm.
Right there.
I think it's internalized color, or I guess it's internalized racism.
More internalized colorism, yeah.
Yeah, colorism is the word, the official term for skin tonism.
Skin toneness. Yes.
Yeah, because I don't think it was, like, that she wanted Sierra to, you know, date white guys or anything like that.
No, it was just that she wanted her to date a guy who was lighter than her, basically.
That comment about, like, lighter than the sole of your foot or something, but aren't the soles of your feet pretty light?
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's the idea, right? Is that, like, that she wanted her to date someone who, like, is not just lighter than her, but, like, multiple shades lighter than her.
I wasn't gonna bring this up, but out of the four of us discussing right now, three of us are white, yeah?
Yep.
So, Shelly, I don't want to put you on the spot, but do you have anything to say about it?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, I think it's definitely a real problem that happens. I think it was definitely interesting to have that character who was really, you know, she didn't affect any of the other parts of the plot. It was really just, like, that sort of maybe even subplot, you know, related to body positivity and, you know, colorism. Is that the word?
Yes,
colorism?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so I think it was really interesting and pretty realistic to have, you know, those sort of people who you think would be role models to the younger generation, but they're actually sort of perpetuating, you know, these thoughts that are not positive and, you know, not good towards your overall sort of, like, self-esteem and, you know, the way you do things in life.
I thought for Sierra's character development, having that scene where she stands up to Tia Rosa was great. I thought it was amazing. Because it tied in not only with, like, the subplot of body positivity but also like her growth as a character in general and her self-confidence growth and being able to handle all these things that she has to deal with. I thought that was really cool.
Wait, can we go back for a sec? Because I wanted to
what?
Say how awesome Robbie's tattoos
were. Oh my
were.
God, right? Sir.
Yeah, like, we were talking about, like, people's heritage earlier, and he really embraced that. He, you know, got them tattooed all over his body, and that was a very, like, drastic thing. But it was also, you know, I kind of have to wonder, like, if that happened before or after he became a Shadow Shaper.
Yeah.
How much that affected it, because, you know, the way he used those in his magic, I guess, was really awesome.
Yeah, because I didn't even think about that. Like, when the tattoos were first described, I was just like, holy cow, like, that's awesome. That's, like, a really cool concept. Like, yeah, like, that's really cool. And I didn't even think about, like, the fact that he could use them like that. And then when he does, and you're like, oh, it's, like, it's almost like it's a metaphor for, like, all the strength that you're drawing from your previous generations, and that's really cool.
Oh, yeah, that is true. I didn't really think about it that way either.
I think something, this is completely, has no bearing on the story at all, but aren't they high school students?
Yeah.
How did he get, like, full body tattoos as a high school student? Or did it be 18?
I mean, legally?
Careful.
I know quite a few people who were tattooed before they were 18. You just have to know someone.
Yeah.
He might also have, like, you know, brothers or something. Are you allowed to have your siblings take
depends
you
in? On the state.
Get tattoos?
I think depending on the state, there's something about adult consent, isn't there?
Yeah, but it has to be parent-guardian.
That's what I
figured. Parent-guardian consent or something.
Speaking of Rob's parents and guardians, I feel like they were not in the book, and that was weird.
Yeah, no, that was super weird. Well, wasn't he, I mean, Acevedo, right, was his mentor. In the shadow shaping arts, but yeah, like, did they even talk about Robbie's parents?
No, not at all. And they never discussed, like, how he even met his mentor and why he became, like, a shadow. Like, why all the other dudes are like, yeah, shadow shaping's dead, Lucera's gone, we don't care anymore. And then, like, this one dude is like, I'm gonna take a prodigy. And
I'm gonna take an apprentice.
Like, it's kind of weird, right? I don't know. It's not really important. I just thought this struck me as kind of strange. I wrote down somewhere, like, why Robbie?
No, that is really strange. It is really strange because everyone else's families, like, you at least know exist. Like, you have Betty's brother that they talk about, and, like, Sierra's entire extended family is there, and, like, the community is really present. So it is, it does strike me as really bizarre that we don't ever encounter Robbie's family.
Did I imagine this? Or somewhere when he was first introduced or first mentioned, they said something about him being, like, a new kid?
Yes. No, you did not imagine that. That's totally a thing. Where is it?
So then I was wondering, if he's a new kid, how did he get trained by this community guy?
Yeah, so it said, it says that he showed up in the middle of the year. Like, I guess he was a transfer student. Mm-hmm.
Maybe Robbie's a ghost.
Plot twist coming from Shadow Paper 2.
Shadowkeeper 2. Robbie's the spirit. He's the Lucero. Yeah, don't include that joke. That's not good.
He's Lucero.
Gato, I don't know.
What was that spooky sound? Did anyone else hear a spooky sound?
Robbie's it was here. Robbie! Please cut all of this. It's nonsense.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I kind of just assumed Robbie was, like, an orphan.
I just didn't assume anything. I didn't really assume anything, I guess. He was just there, and there was no family. I mean, I guess you don't really encounter, like, T and Izzy's families, or Jerome's family, or anything like that.
Yeah, that's true.
And Benny, you really only hear about her brother.
But, like, at least they have,
so
like,
go to his house.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Like, they exist in some facility besides, like, their relationship with Sierra, which...
Yeah,
I don't know. It's not important at all. It's really not a big deal. It just seemed weird in a story that so heavily focuses on family for her love interest to just be like this random dude.
Yeah. No, that is weird. And you'd think that, like, if he was a Shadow Shaper, it'd be possible that he had ancestors who were Shadow Shapers or, like...
Right.
Something. And yet, you don't really see that.
Well... It seems like he didn't have the, you know, direct family members, at least, because, he didn't get it from them.
That's true. It was given to him as, like... Well, I guess we'll never know. That's fine.
It's not fine. It's not fine. It's never fine.
Help, what haven't we discussed? Okay, the ending. So we talked about how it seems like she's initiating her friends, which is kind of weird because we don't know if they have the prerequisite blood background or whatever. I personally liked the ending. I thought it followed along the theme of community and family. But what did you guys think?
I thought the weirdest thing for me wasn't the epilogue, but was the section before the epilogue. Because, you know, they fight their way up the tower. There's, like, there are obstacles along the way. And then they finally find Robbie. And then they find Wick. And then, like, it just felt really anticlimactic. Like, after she beats Wick, then she just, like, goes down the stairs. And there's, like, a line where it just says, like, the friends exchange stories about what happened. And then it, like, moves on. And, like, I just thought that was really, like, I was like, where is the denouement? Why is there nothing, like, why is there no, like, slow down? Like, because I don't know, and maybe this is just me, but I really like to see characters process their reactions to big happenings like that. And you don't really get that. It just kind of ends, and then there's an epilogue where everything's fine. And so, like, personally, like, that's what bothered me about the end of the book more than anything else.
It sort of felt like a movie ending. Like, they all walked out into the dawn from that building.
You know what I pictured? I pictured Gina Torres in Firefly, or in Serenity, sorry. Spoilers for Serenity. Like, at Walt's funeral. Because I was like, oh, like, this is, like, you walk out into the sunshine, everybody's all dressed up, like, that's what's happening right now. So yeah, it definitely felt it. Yeah, it did. It felt like a movie ending more or than
like,
a book ending.
Like they're bruised and battered, but in a pretty kind of way.
Yeah,
like someone has a scratch across the cheek, and her friend leans over to touch it, and it's like, oh.
Oh, and can we talk about how Robbie's not even bruised anymore? Because apparently Sierra just healed him.
Yeah, wait, what? Yeah, since when is healing a power?
Like, where did that come from?
I guess it's a Lucera thing.
I guess it's not like. We don't know what Lucera is ahead of, you know, Sierra becoming her, so it's, you know, not totally crazy, I guess, for her to have, you know, random powers we don't know about, but that's not what I was expecting.
I kind of hope that he writes more in this, like, in this series, because I feel like there must be, like, depths and depths of Lucera powers that we just don't know anything about, because her grandma doesn't really explain anything.
She's just like,
here you go. It's yours now. Like, what is that?
Yeah, I think that was my problem with the book at the end. I thought that the ending, like, epilogue and all the fight and whatever, that was okay for me. But the Lucera twist was, I don't know. I didn't dislike it necessarily, but I thought it was kind of weird. It was just like, I'm your grandma waiting in this random river for you. Or not river, ocean for you.
Ocean.
And now you're here, and now you are Lucera. That was just, I don't know. It felt, I was confused.
Yeah, at first I really thought it was going to be like Lucera just taking the form of her grandmother to be like a more familiar figure. But then, you know, it clearly wasn't that. It was actually her. So yeah, I did find that a little weird and like, you know, a little too convenient maybe.
Speaking of too convenient, the fact that her grandma just like takes her away and they, like, fly away instead of immediately going to help her friends. Like, that was a little bizarre. I was like, why are we flying over the city instead of, what's happening on the beach? Oh, look at that, Robbie's gone. How did that happen? It's, like, because we left.
There was, like, some weird comment about, like, how, you know, her abuela couldn't be in the real world, which kind of implied that, like, they weren't in the real world anymore. I was really confused there.
Oh, when they were floating?
Yeah, when they were floating and they were, like, getting that aerial view of the city, it seemed like they were in some sort of different place. But...
So at some point, she maybe, like, crossed over into a spirit world, and then we just didn't really get that explicitly, well, I guess.
I guess maybe the grandma wasn't waiting literally in the ocean. She was waiting in the spirit world, like, she the was, reflection of that area, and maybe that's why.
Oh, yeah, maybe they were in the reflection.
That would make more sense to me.
That would make more sense. I just need there to be, like, a reason that they didn't immediately go help, because that seems like that would be the logical response to the situation.
Because they needed time for Robert to get kidnapped, of course.
Well, yes, but unless her grandma was conspiring with Wick, I would hope that that would be the in-world plot reason. Twist.
Convenient kidnapping. Oh, speaking of plot twists, did anyone else think that the librarian...
Nidia.
That Sierra put her trust in Nidia too quickly. She goes from not knowing who this person is to letting her know where she is every minute of the day. So at first, when Sierra starts getting suspicious that someone's following her, I'm like, well, gee, maybe it's the person you texted your itinerary to. Did anyone else feel that way, or am I just suspicious?
Well, I mean, Sierra had the exact same thought, right? She's like, it's you!
She went and, like, snuck up on her with a fire extinguisher, like, ready to brain her.
That's how I normally approach strangers, though.
I actually thought Nidia was way weirder because Sierra was calling her with these, like, super vague phone calls. Like, I'm gonna go do something dramatic. Hang up. I'm gonna go to Coney Island in the middle of the night. And she says, like, she does, like, advise her not to, but then, you know, it was like a four-sentence phone call. Like, it was super weird. I don't know.
Bring some snacks.
Yeah, I didn't understand how, like, Nidia never really, like, at least as far as I recall, had, like, a real initiation into, like, so, FYI, these mystic powers actually exist, and we are literally communing with spirits at all times.
I think she knew that because she read all of Wick's journals.
Wait, hold up. Like, was it Nidia or Nadia?
Nidia.
Oh, okay, sorry.
It's a Y, isn't it?
It's a Y.
Yeah. I read it as NA, like, the whole book. I don't know why I do that.
It's more common to be a Nadia, I guess.
Sorry, I feel bad for flirting it.
Yeah, that she did read Wick's papers, but I think it's one thing to, like, just, like, read the papers of an anthropologist, and another thing, especially an anthropologist like Wick, who's, like, incredibly self-important, and you could believe that he, like, made things up, versus, like, just letting a 16-year-old go off to deal with spirits? Like, how do you not have more of a reaction to that? Like, especially, I mean, she's a mom.
I kind of expected her to join the squad. I mean, it's not realistic because she has small children, but, like, that seemed like a moment where, I'm going to Coney Island, just FYI, okay, I'll meet you there. Like, that kind of seemed like that moment.
I mean, or at least that they'd have some discussion about, like, okay, like, if you're not back in 3 hours, like, I don't know, I'm calling the police or something, you know, like, some emergency plan, or, like, I'm calling your mom, I don't know, like, just, like, some...
Yeah, it would have been nice for that to be a little more explicit, because it seemed sort of like it was going towards that, like, you know, Sierra was calling her because she was the only one she could tell about this that wasn't with her, but, yeah...
She also takes her to the Sorrows.
Yes. Well, she has to show her where they are, I guess. You know, you can't just give her a map, clearly. I mean, I kind of liked her joining them later. It was amusing, you know, seeing her with, you know, Neville, the godfather. That was a cute scene.
That's happening.
Yeah. Did anyone else think it was weird that Sierra kind of, like, believed her? She's like, oh, it's definitely you. You are definitely a spy. And I'm about to, like, whack you on the head with this fire extinguisher. And then she's like, no, it's not me. She's like, okay, it's not you.
Yes. I definitely expected that.
I would still be, like, super suspicious.
I definitely expected that confrontation to be, like, more dramatic. And then it wasn't. It was just like, oh, okay, so, yeah, it's not you.
Yeah, I think that was where the book started getting a little rushed for me.
Agreed. Yeah, so another set of side characters that I know people had wanted to discuss were Sierra's friends Izzy and T.
Okay, so I can't get over that there are two members of our, like, core ensemble who are lesbians canonically in a relationship. And the beginning, like, the first line where they mention it is where, like, Izzy's rapping, and they have a line where it's like, T watched her girlfriend from the circle or whatever, and I was like, oh my gosh, author, please do not be of the generation that uses girlfriend as a word that does not mean girlfriend. please, I didn't even think of that,
but yeah.
I just assumed right away that they were lesbians. It didn't even occur to me that it was, like, my girlfriend.
I've been burned before.
Oh no.
But yeah, that was cool. I to be completely honest with you, about halfway through the book, I was like, when they started like bickering or whatever about, I guess it was when they were like going to Coney Island. But even like before that, when they go down in the basement and find like Manny dead, and I guess it's Benny's boyfriend, I can't remember. And Izzy's like if I'm going, like you're going to whatever, and she like takes his hand, and I was like, oh, what's happening here? And then like later, like Izzy like leaves, like she and T fight, right? And they like she leaves with that guy. I can't remember his name right now.
Jerome.
Yeah, Jerome. Thank you. They leave, and I was like, oh my god, like they're gonna break up. Like she's gonna like date this guy instead. I was really sad, and then it didn't happen. And no, I was like,
there's
oh.
There's also a line where Izzy's like, to T, right? Izzy's like, what kind of lesbian are you, or something. So like, I think Izzy's definitely like. Definitely, definitely, definitely a lesbian.
Okay. Like, I guess I definitely. Didn't really think about it. I was just like, oh, they're going to break up. Oh.
Yes.
I also thought it was refreshing. Ooh. I also thought it was very refreshing to have a couple be part of the ensemble and have them not be attached to the hip, constantly agreeing. Like, I thought it was really mm-hmm. solid that we can have one person who goes along and one who doesn't, because we're human beings and human beings can make choices.
And can have arguments and get over it.
Yeah.
That's the other thing. Like, you don't see them get over it, but, like, then they're fine in the epilogue. So, like, I think, like, also showing that, like, hey, like, you can have a relationship where you don't agree on everything, and yet things are going to be all right. Like, I definitely appreciated that also.
I think that's a great point. I didn't think about that at all. I guess I'm just so used to, like, typical YA relationship fiascos that I was, like, the first sign of trouble, I was like, they're done. That's a really good point. I actually really like that now that I'm thinking about it.
Yeah, and I kind of liked how different they were. Like, Izzy was really into the rapping, right? But she was also into, like, you know, fancy coffee shops, which I thought was really funny.
Yeah.
And everyone else was kind of like... Well, I guess T was the one who was talking really loudly when they were at that coffee shop.
Yes. I'm going to write a book. It's going to be about white people.
Yeah, that was hilarious.
Oh, white people.
Yeah, I liked that scene a lot. It was really funny.
All right, so we are actually coming up on an hour. I know that we got off topic a few times, but it's looking like we might have covered most everything in the doc. Was there anything else?
Did Louisa get out her Bennie thoughts?
So, Louisa, you wrote a blog post about how important Bennie was. Do you want to just give us a few sentences on that thought?
Yeah, so the blog post is basically about how, like, this book subverts a whole lot of YA fantasy tropes, which we've talked about, but one of the tropes that has always bothered me is the idea that somehow the protagonist, like, has a best friend who, you know, they've known forever, and, like, they have a strong enough bond with them to call them, like, that's their best friend, and yet, like, when the protagonist, like, tells their best friend, like, you won't believe what just happened to me, like, this just happened to me, the friend doesn't believe what just happened to them. And so, like, reading the scene between Sierra and Bennie, where Sierra goes to tell Bennie, like, what happened, I was definitely, like, I was super anxious, like, the whole time that Bennie wasn't going to believe her, and now, like, here's this conflict, and now we're going to deal with resolving this conflict instead of, like, moving forward with the plot of the book. And that doesn't happen. So that's mainly what I talk about in the blog post.
Yeah, I mean, in general, I thought that was great, like, how, you know, the majority of her friends, at least, didn't, you know, immediately abandon her and, you know, not believe her and stuff, because that's always super frustrating in books, when no one believes the main character, and they're struggling the whole time to prove themselves, and of course, they're right in the end, but, yeah. So I like that her friends actually trusted her, you know, they were real friends. Most of them.
And I really did appreciate that, like, Izzy and Jerome then were like, no, I'm out. Because, like, no matter if you're friends or not, like, there might come a point like that where you're just like, this is too weird. Like, I can't deal with something that's this weird. And so I can understand them having that response. And I think it made it a little more realistic than it would have seemed if everyone was immediately just like, yeah, of course, this is what's happening. So I don't know. I appreciated that they left, even though it was kind of a moment of like, no, guys.
Well, I think that, again, like we've said, this book's very realistic. We've got catcalling, we've got racism. I love my friends, and there's a lot I would do for my friends, but if they're going into this alternate demon universe where their grandmother is a god, and, like, I would be wary.
I mean, not even that far. Like, even just, like, I want you to come out to Coney Island with me at night. Like, that yeah. would be enough for me to be like,
really? Yeah, good point.
Hear you?
Are you sure? got someone else you could call?
I also thought it was kind of interesting, like, how Sara didn't feel the need to prove herself. Like, she didn't do any shadow shaping to sort of show them. Because, yeah. I mean, at least from what I gathered from the book, like, if they were looking for it, they would have been able to see it. Mm-hmm. It seemed like, at least.
Yeah, so, it was like, anybody can see it, they're just not looking for it.
Or the, so if they were looking for yeah. it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But it was like they didn't want it to be real. It's kind of like the mom and the aunt. Mm-hmm. It's exactly the same. Like, they didn't want it, they rejected it.
And then, yeah, and you see what you want to see. And there are all kinds of, like psychological studies that say that, like, that's pretty much true. Like, that your mind will fill in what you expect. And so I think, yeah, so I think that was a good way to frame that, I think.
Mm. Because, like, if you think about it, like, when Robbie and Sara went to the club, like, the walls were, like, mm-hmm. dancing, right? And nobody noticed. So even if she had tried to show them, they might not have even been able to see it. So.
Yeah. Like, if they were already closed-minded to it or whatever, then, yeah, I think they
appreciate it. Well, obviously, they come around to the end, and what? I really, if there's a Shadow Shaper 2, I'd like to see Izzy use her shadow shaping for her rapping, because that would be really cool.
That would be really cool. That was something that I hadn't thought about until you mentioned it. And then I was like, yeah, because yeah. like, then like, she, I mean, the she could be another storyteller like Lazaro was, but
yeah, exactly,
with
exactly.
rap, like, instead of just with, like, talking.
Oh, actually, I wanted to ask about that really quick if we have time about, so in the book, like, most examples of shadow shaping that we see are with, like, physical art. So mm-hmm. Robbie explains that, like, you're giving the spirits a form, and so that's why they work with you. But if it's, like, storytelling or rapping, how would that work?
Well, they mentioned that the way that Lazaro did it, he would just stand there and start talking to himself and, like, or talking to the spirits, technically. And then they would do whatever he said was happening would happen. So I think, like, the form that he's giving them is, like, a sequence of events. Like, it's not just, like, it's not like he's giving them a physical form, but that the events that he's describing just, like, are powered then by the spirits, if that makes sense.
So do you think that it's, like, a play? Like, they would, like, kind of act it out, and the people around, like, kind of see it subconsciously, and that's why the storytelling was so powerful?
I don't think they see it subconsciously. I think that they see it, like, consciously.
Really? Okay.
Like, I think he's, like, affecting, like, the physical world.
Oh, okay.
Right? I don't know.
That seems, like, even more powerful than, you know, what the artist can do, because, you know, you don't need a physical thing to put the spirits into, you just use
yeah,
your words.
Yeah, which is why, I mean, they mentioned that, like, storytelling is, like, rare, and that her grandfather was, like, super powerful.
Mm-hmm, right.
That's true.
Okay.
Anyway, it's cool. It's really interesting.
Should we do a wrap-up question?
So our wrap-up question for the night is gonna be, if you were a shadow shaper, what form would your magic take? And I think that I would have to say knitting. I am not very talented in visual arts or in storytelling, as you may have determined by me tripping over my own tongue multiple times on book table episodes. But I do love knitting, and I find it very relaxing. So I think that I would be creating hats and scarves that the spirits would, and it would be very helpful, because then they could ride on your head and give you advice. So that's,
I'm imagining, like, that. The flying carpet from Aladdin.
Yes,
absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely. All right, Louisa?
It wouldn't be very fast, though. You would be like, oh, I gotta fight this fat guy. Let me knit this scarf real quick.
Robbie has his tattoos.
Yeah, he has his ready-made tattoos.
Oh, that's true.
I wear like, at least 3 hand-knit things every day. I just took a hand-knit crocheted thing off my head. But whatever, knitting's better.
Mm. Okay. mine, I mean, I do write and I do draw a lot, even though I draw really badly. But I think that mine would probably be music, because that's something that I do constantly.
either like with tapping and rhythm, and we had a little bit of an issue earlier where Dorothy handed me an object and then I couldn't keep my hand still with it. So we had some sound problems. But I also, like, I whistle and sing constantly in my everyday life, and I think that that's definitely where it would come out for me.
Which is also a theme that you will see in our upcoming fiction podcast.
Yes, I know. I wonder if I can blame Pycera for that.
But. Yeah.
All right.
Sara?
I've been thinking about the whole time you guys have been talking. This is a really difficult question for me. I actually took art, like, all through high school, but I'm, like, not talented in any specific thing. I'm just, like, mildly okay. Everything. The only artistic thing I really do these days, I'm really into fashion, but I don't make it. Oh, that's actually not true. I do crafting. I make like accessories sometimes. They're really bad though. But I do patchwork, which is not like sewing. It's like this weird thing where you like push fabric into this like styrofoam thing. I really don't know how to describe it. I don't even know what you would call it in English. In Japanese, it's pachiwaku. So that's just patchwork. Okay. But it's really fun, and I haven't done it enough recently, so maybe I would do more or do it better if it was my shadow shaping skill.
Awesome. That's pretty cool. I've never heard of that.
Yeah, I don't know. It's like a thing my host mom did, so now I do it too. I have no idea what it is exactly.
Well, send us a picture so that we can include it in the blog post for this, because that sounds really neat.
Yeah, we can tweet it out.
It's not, like, exciting. It's, like, very, like, think about, like, quilt pictures that old ladies hang on their walls. It's like that. But it's, like,
that sounds awesome.
That does sound really cool, Sara.
I think you're selling yourself
short here.
So, yeah, I guess for me, I don't know, my first instinct was sort of what Dorothy said, you know, knitting and crocheting. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I mean, I do a lot of crafts. Yeah, I mean, I guess I do a lot of crafts, like not only knitting, crocheting, sometimes like cross stitching or what else have I done recently? I do sometimes play instruments, but not too often. But I think something I was thinking of from, you know, something I haven't really done recently, but when I was younger, I used to do a lot of origami. So I think you can make really cool things.
That'd be really neat.
With that those. Really cool.
Amazing. Yeah.
I'm just like imagining like a crane like flying away.
Yeah.
Like an army of cranes.
Yeah.
I remember like in elementary school, like all the boys used to love making the little ninja stars. So, you know, those would definitely be useful. Some of them would definitely be more involved, like, you know, got to carry your scissors around to make the right cuts, but...
Yeah. You could, like, have a handful in your pocket, like, Dorothy and her scarf.
Yeah, yeah.
But you could also have really basic things, too. Like, Sierra has a moment where she just draws slashes and animates them. So you could animate a paper airplane.
Mm-hmm.
You know? You could have your paper airplane fly somewhere.
I've never made a successful paper airplane, but...
But if you could animate it, it would be successful.
It automatic.
That is true. If it doesn't need to fly, like, on its own.
Yeah.
Thank you guys for joining me today to talk about this book. We hope that you had fun. We hope that the listeners have fun listening to it. Remember to keep an eye on Backroom Whispering website, because we do have a lot of awesome blog posts coming out at least once a week, if not twice a week. We will also be having another book table episode next month in April about non-Western themes in fantasy. So that's going to be a really interesting topic to tune into. And again, we'll be tweeting and Facebooking some of the background reading, some of the books that we're going to be talking about, so that listeners have a chance to see or read before they listen. So thanks again for tuning in, and see you next time on the book table.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial by going to audibletrial.com/thebooktable. The Book Table is a podcast from Backroom Whispering Productions. Our theme music is by Mark Wayne. If you like this podcast, rate us on iTunes, or get in touch with us on Twitter at Backroom Whisper, on Facebook at facebook.com/backroomwhispering, or by email, backroomwhispering@gmail.com. Tune in again next time! Thank you.